I thought we'd start with some music to get us into the mood. It's slightly over the top, perhaps. The words, or a selection of the words, are in your files on that lyric sheet. It's a song to the tune of Gabriel's oboe from The Mission. But the song is sung by a young soprano who I have only recently discovered and I love, Hayley Westenra, some of you may have heard her. And the, in case you can't hear the lyrics, I thought it was appropriate for today's talk. The extract from the lyrics that I've got on the sheet reads, "Whispers in a dream, the world is quiet and waiting, all around the air is still. When all is come to pass, the storm has breathed its last. The rain has washed our fear away. Love will fall on us all." And just when I was listening to that and looking at those lyrics, I just thought, well, that captures something of what I want to say today. The title of my talk being "Sailing into Sunlight, a Quiet Atmosphere of Grace." So before I begin, hopefully, we'll just listen to this music. Oh, and the other connection, and by the way, I do have two peppermints for Mary somewhere. the other connection was simply this idea of mission, which was so strong in Janet's life, in her service in the society, in England and Ireland and Scotland, but then throughout the world. But it reminded me too of her sense of early call to go on the missions. It was always something that was not quite fulfilled in her, and I just thought it would be a nice tribute to play this. Off we go.
Thank you.
So, we've taken, is this on? This is on.
Yeah?
Yes. We've taken a wandering journey through Janet's childhood and young womanhood. We've reflected on how she sought her telos and found and was found by God. Attracted into friendship with Christ through her response to the circumstances of her childhood, in nature, in the challenge of learning, in her response to bereavement and mourning, her desire to communicate, to teach, to be useful, her desire to find her telos or her purpose, her desire to be at home. Her father once chided her that she had given him everything but her confidence. The home she had longed for was one where she lived in confidence with God, where she was the special other as Mary Magdalene for Christ. Her journey in prayer after she had entered the society seems to have been a process of seeking a way of praying that responded to a felt invitation to go out towards an unknown God. And she learned to use imaginative meditation as a way of opening both her mind and her heart to the Spirit, and learned at the same time to let go of her natural desire for control, for perfection, for being the captain, as it were, of her own ship. In this final section, I want to consider the ways in which that dynamic of friendship with God in Christ, which had been developing all her life, began to play out in her own reflections, private and shared, in the last few years of her life. This is a dimension which had been present all the time, the dimension of give me only your love, in the sense of give me the love with which you love. And this is the dimension that I think is to the fore here. In June 1913, during a visit to Roehampton, she was asked what her favourite method of prayer was. All the novices sitting in a circle, each one had been told you must ask Mother a question. Engage in conversation with our Mother General. Somebody came up with this rather good question. And she replied, next to St. Ignatius, I love the Carthusian way. Why? Asked the novice. Because, she said, it was simple, and because it permeated the lives of the Carthusians, and was not confined to specific hours of office. Prayer is an atmosphere, she added, not a skeleton, alluding to her insight that whatever one did to prepare prayer should free the spirit into God's presence, not trap it in one's own sophistry. Janet's comment about atmosphere deserves to be paused over. Atmosphere, she has begun to think in 1909, is the best value of meditative prayer, the moment when it turns into contemplation, in fact. In a reflection on a meditation about Mary during 1909, she writes, these meditations make in my mind an atmosphere of Mary, full of wonder, overwhelming in beauty, and I like to stay there with a consciousness that somehow this atmosphere is altering the quality of my soul. It changes one somehow, though one could not quite put it into words. Changes it as beauty subdues restlessness and silences one's soul. I looked at her with the unreflecting, unanalyzing look of the peasant, and I was very happy with her. What about this rather surprising peasant? It isn't easy to imagine Janet, the child of intertwined aristocratic families, the scion of rich landowners in Ireland, who had complacently, albeit entirely in the spirit of Victorian noblesse oblige, taught the children of Irish tenants and sweet-talked their parents into paying their rents without making any more fuss. It's hard to imagine such a person as a peasant, in any other sense than Marie Antoinette. But I think she has in mind Ignatius's recommendation in a meditation on the Nativity that one might imagine oneself gazing at the scene as a simple maidservant, putting aside one's busy mind for a while, one's natural skepticism, and simply gazing, taking it in. Janet had been in touch with the Carthusian tradition for some years before her reference to it in 1913. The first reference I've come across is to Goodyear in her undated notes of about 1909, in which she quotes from a Carthusian mystic, Dominic de Treves, whose dates are apparently 1384 to 1461. The quote you can see on the screen. Without any mental images, but with the sole force of your intelligence and your will, frequently offer, plunge, abandon your heart and your spirit into the very dear or sweet heart of our Lord Jesus Christ, your Creator, your Saviour, your crucified friend. I must just tell you how excited I was in my trivial sort of way when I thought, who is this Dominic de Treves? Where has she found out about him? Not on the internet, evidently. It wasn't invented in those days. And in 11 Norham Gardens in Oxford, I found a little volume of Carthusian extracts from Carthusian writings. It had originally been published in 1694 for Carthusian nuns. But an English edition was first published in 1895, just around the time that Janet became vicar and in charge of who read what in the library at Roehampton. Now there's a more recent edition of the same book in Norham Gardens, and in the front it says the Community Library, Hove, Brighton. So it's obviously been, at least since 1894, 1895, part of the community reading. And the second extract in it is exactly this extract from Dominic de Treves. The first one is from Ludolf of Saxony, who was the same Ludolf of Saxony, yes, that Ignatius read on his sickbed while he was waiting for his leg to heal, the Vita Christi. So the connections between Ignatian and Carthusian spirituality run way back. I just enjoyed that. So, what did this extract say to her? It seemed to be saying prayer that is non-cognitive, direct, simple, imageless, a prayer of self-abandonment, yet still requiring total commitment of intelligence and of will. And she would have added, of heart. It is this, she says to Goodyear, that she increasingly prefers to the classic imaginative meditation. I think that what she was becoming aware of more confidently at this point was the contemplative dimension of meditation, the openness, imageless gaze in the templum, or the open, consecrated space, where God is with us in looking and being looked at in the loving interchange of friends. Another speculative point I want to make is about a movement in Janet from what we might call, forgive me this, from what we might call cataphatic to apophatic prayer. I will. Don't you know? Don't you? When you sit down to pray, Mama Rudy, think, today I shall choose cataphatic prayer. Now, these are technical terms referring to prayer in which the outpouring of God's Spirit is expressed in words or in other creative means, that's cataphatic, and to prayer that waits in the space where any expression of who God is experienced as limiting and therefore in some way unsatisfactory, the prayer of unknowing, apophatic. Now, I don't at all think that this movement was merely a progressive one, or in any sense a progressive one, from A to B, in the sense of, for example, cataphatic might be seen as an earlier stage. I don't think that's true. I think Janet was increasingly able to identify both dimensions of prayer as going on at the same time, and was able to hold them in a complex whole, moving from one to the other as the Spirit moved. But a phase of this learning was to become more at peace with the apophatic style, more aware of God's presence in it, rather than just as a necessary time to get through before experiencing God's presence. You know, the sense in which we might sometimes think, this is the dark night of the soul, nothing is happening, and I've got to endure this and wait for it until God makes himself known again. That may be the case sometimes, but I think here, Janet is becoming aware that God is there in that darkness. She seems to be taking steps towards a deeper self-forgetfulness, or to put it the other way, more attentiveness to the divine other. A conscious, alert, but emptied and unself-conscious attention. She describes acting as if one was oblivious of self, rather dismissively in one place, as elementary self-abnegation. What she is after now, she says to Goodyear, is to live with a constant hush on the movement of the Spirit within herself, almost not paying it attention, as too much attention might spoil it all, by too great an attention to repress it. The true self-oblivion of love, she recognizes now, must be a gift from God. The interface between cataphatic and apophatic appears most intensely to us in a conference given at Roehampton at Christmas 1909. She invites the community to be brave enough to speak their minds fully to God. That is all prayer requires. This speaking could be done in the spirit of the second week, the spirit of following Christ and his standard, conversing with him about the ways he shows the love of his heart. Or, she goes on, if it suits the soul better, converse with him in the spirit of the fourth week. And there is not much to be said there. Though the little that is said, says a great deal. Dites oh, en silence, n'y ajoutant rien, au adorer, au louer, au désirer, au attendre, au entrer dans son néant, au renaître avec le Sauveur, au s'unir à lui, au s'étonner de son bonheur dans une chaste jouissance, au être doux et humble de cœur, qui a-t-il de moins qu'un O? Mais qu'y a-t-il de plus grand, de plus grand que ce cri de cœur? Toute l'éloquence du monde est dans cet eau. Et je ne sais plus qu'en dire, tant je m'y perds. and you've got the translation of some of that in front of you. I think this rhapsodic passage is fascinating. First, it is in French, in the context of an English conference given to English sisters. Of course, French was the first language of the society, and all the choir nuns listening to her would have understood her. But why did she suddenly go into French? I think it indicates that she was now on sacred, intimate ground with them, and stepping into French afforded her some psychological protection. French was also a language in which perhaps it was easier for an upper-class Englishwoman to express emotion than English was. Just speculatively, I don't know. Secondly, and this is the much more important thing for our purposes, it combines an outpouring of words, quite, it goes on a bit, with an emphasis on the little word, O. It is her O antiphon for Christmas. What is less than this little word, O, she says, yet what is greater than this cry of the heart? All the eloquence of the world is in this O. And she ends in apophasis. I do not know what more to say, for I have lost myself there. I weighed out, she had written to Goodyear, until I am overwhelmed. Wait on God in an attitude of expectation, hopeful and silent, she advised the community in Melbourne in 1914. Doing the common things you have to do in your daily work, teaching grammar and maths, strapping trunks, I love that bit, all day in his presence, like the Carthusians, not discoursing about God's presence, but hushed and steadied and silenced by it. Like Our Lady, she thought, uniting our powers of mind. I think she may, well, I don't know whether she has Mater Admirabilis in mind or not, but certainly many pictures of Our Lady showing her studying scripture, many of the medieval pictures. Uniting our powers of mind to our desire, a desire that God encourages, and the more he answers it, the more our desire grows. We can never reach the end, she said. Our life is so simple, so matter of fact, so, quote, absolutely nothing, unquote, but so immense once we begin to love. And Goodyear wrote to Maud Monaghan in 1921, after her dark night, she sailed into sunlight, became very quiet, without troubling any more about doubts. I think that bit is interesting. It's not that she didn't have doubts anymore, but they didn't bother her, he felt. They didn't trouble her in the same way. So, next slide, please. If Janet Stuart was a discoverer of her own life, what did she discover? Part of what she discovered was paradoxically how to stop earnestly searching and to allow God to be the discoverer of her, to allow God to be the discoverer to her of himself and therefore of herself. She has been on a journey, in part, from prayer conceived of as an act of will and a busy mind, to prayer in which an atmosphere of grace works upon the one who prays, a prayer of quiet that is full of love, whilst increasingly empty of images and words, increasingly trusting and confident. I don't agree with the implication that Goodyear and from him Monaghan seem to suggest at the end of Maud Monaghan's biography, that Janet had become had come to the end of her potential spiritual journey by October 1914, and in the tradition of being too good for this world, was therefore taken by God. After all, Janet was still in 1913, rather keen on persuading the community at Timaru in New Zealand that they can do what they will. Not you can do whatever you want, but if you make up your mind to something, you can do it. So pull your socks up. That was still happening sometimes in her conferences. But I do think that in the generosity of her self-sharing, in her letters, in her conferences and other writings, we can trace a voyage that had gone some way towards integration of some of the tensions and losses in her life. From a conflict between mind and heart to their integration, from a search for a mother to perhaps beginning to find one in Mary. From stress on living with an eye to the hereafter to being hospitable to the God in the present moment. And above all, from the passionate desire to be one of Christ's intimate friends to the security of knowing she was one. And what has she to say to us? There are many things we might find missing in her spirituality. For example, she speaks only in a limited way to the emphasis we now put on social justice and the cry of the poor. There is no whiff of criticism of the hierarchical church in any of her writings. We might, to be honest, find her emphasis too much on the inward relationship of Christ and the individual soul, in isolation from the social and political context in which we work. And certainly this could be argued of the Janet I have presented here. I suspect, to be fair, it would be possible to dig out broader social emphasis from the spirituality of her educational work, but even this will be found to be limited in ways we would not be comfortable with today. But what I find inspiring is the way that she was, in my humble opinion, extraordinarily ordinary. She was not a visionary foundress, like Sophie, nor a heroic pioneer, like Philippine, nor a martyr, I don't know if we've ever had any of those, yet. Though she was open-minded, she was not radical, nor in any way a revolutionary thinker. And I'm not sure whether we've had any of those either, but perhaps we have. She had an extraordinary combination of gifts of mind and heart, which made her an influential educator and a very practical and wise administrator. She was certainly a leader. Whether she would ever have been a prophetic leader of the society, we will never know. But she had a deep intuition of the things of God, and her position as vicar and then as superior general, combined with her generosity of spirit and her outstanding powers of communication, enabled her to bequeath to us discoveries she made as she, in her words, mined in the vein of spiritual things. And I, for one, find these discoveries helpful precisely because they are both ordinary and fundamental, experiencing and recognizing a transforming dynamic of finding and being found by the love of God through putting on Christ's mind and heart to learning to love with his heart. To adapt what she said to the Roehampton community in her last letter to them in 1914, with which I started, it was something for her own hunger and thirst, and something to give to others. That is us. Amen.